Shweb Wednesday. Welcome, welcome, welcome. 欢迎, 欢迎. Bienvenue. Whatever. Jokoso. So thanks for coming. We've got masses of gifts. So if you're really good and you behave well, you're going to get something. So we're just going to kick off slightly backwards. And we're going to have a gift. Today is a very important day, because apart from Web Wednesday, it's also World Oceans Day. Does anybody know anything about World Oceans Day? Well, you're going to be tested in a moment. It's also World IPv6 Day. But none of you know anything about that, right? There's a few geeks around the corner there. So we're going to have a few words about World Oceans Day in relationship to Hong Kong. So Isabel Jarrett here from Bloom Association, which sounds like a flower company, but actually has got to do with shark's fins, is going to say a few words, and then she's going to test your knowledge of sharks. And if you get it right, you get this book, Man and Shark. Not sharking men, but Man and Shark. And if you get the second one right, you get a book by her boss, who's actually French, but this is translated into Chinese, called The Deep. The Deep. All right, so Isabel, come and say a few words, and then what we'll do is she's going to ask a question. You put your hand up, and I point to you. If you get it right, you get the book. If you don't, you don't.
Thank you, Napoleon. Hello, everybody. I'm Isabel from Bloom. We're a small marine conservation NGO based here in Hong Kong. And like Napoleon said, today is World Ocean Day. So I'm just going to give you a few facts, and I'm going to test your knowledge, see if you know anything about the oceans. So in 2011, more than 80% of our oceans are either fully exploited or overexploited, which basically means that there's not really that many fish left in the sea. So much so that scientists have predicted that by 2048, there's going to be no fish left in the ocean for us to eat. A little bit worrying. But in Hong Kong, I bet you're wondering, okay, what does that have to do with Hong Kong? Okay, so as many of you probably know, Hong Kong is the centre of the global shark fin trade. And it's probably the centre of the global shark fin consumption. So it's estimated that for a 300-person banquet, it takes about 50 large sharks. So that's 50 large sharks in one 300-person banquet. So if you imagine how many weddings or birthdays or Lunar New Year celebrations you go to in 1 year, how many sharks you're helping to eat. So I'm going to get straight to the quiz and see if you guys know anything at all about sharks. So my question to you is, how many sharks do you think are killed each minute for shark fin and other products?
Put your hand up.
Put your hands up if you've got an idea.
Man and shark.
Anybody? Nobody has any idea.
Nobody here cares?
Nobody here cares, apparently.
There you go.
Okay.
Andrew.
200. Okay, 200's close. Anybody else with another guess?
500.
No, a little bit too far away. Anybody else with a guess a little bit closer than 200?
250.
No, 220? No.
198. I knew as soon as it turned to an auction, that people would get interested.
I felt
240, 250, we'll take 250.
Who said
250.
Did anybody say
no.
Oh, he's the closest so far. One last guess.
165.
Did you see it? Well, she was paying attention.
What's the answer?
It's 138. 138 sharks killed per minute.
There we go. Woohoo. Well done.
So if others were paying attention, then you would have seen how many sharks are killed per day. It's that easy.
A day.
Come on, math skills. People.
This is a collector's item. The Deep.
No.
Okay.
Yes, 200,000. Yes.
Well, 200,000. There you go.
Woo-hoo. There you go. Very good guess. Right on the spot on the money.
All right. So last thing, if you're interested in saving sharks, go to facebook.com /Bloom Association, all right? That's the end of the public announcement.
Thank you very much, guys. Enjoy the rest of the evening.
All right, thanks. Thanks a lot, Isabel. All right, cool. So, we have set up, if you're interested, we've got a little Twitter poll thing going. So don't be nasty. If you're too shy to ask a question, it might come up on here. If you're not too shy, I'm just going to put you back onto our sponsors, Reel. So, okay, let's get into the main meat of what we're talking about tonight. My God, something falls around. Let me just tell you what we've got as prizes, because there's some pretty sexy stuff. If you ask a good question, you get this, which is a USB, a CNN Go USB, right? Has it got any content on it?
Yes.
It has? What's it got on it? Oh, it's full of press releases. You can delete the press releases, right? There's also some collector's items, CNN hoodies. So if you want to see a nice girl, exclusive CNN hoodies, go to webwednesday.in and you can see a photo of these being modeled. Right? Then there's a CNN, what's that?
Travel bag.
Includes bandages. And the juiciest thing is this. Does anybody know what this is? A gun? CNN Go website. No? Any guesses? It's a monocular, right? In other words, you can spot things from far away. I'm not going to ask you what you're going to spot. What do you use it for? It's a telescope. All right. So there's your prizes, okay, at the end of the night. Hold it, and there's more to come. But you're all being so noisy that I'm not going to tell you about them. Now don't forget, CNN Go describes itself as... CNN Go describes itself as... the ultimate insider's guide to the region's top travel, entertainment, and lifestyle experiences. So, some of the prizes, if you quieten down a little bit, oi, shh, just half an hour of listening to this guy. Some of the prizes is dinner for two at Ista, voted Hong Kong's best Indian restaurant, right? And then worth 500 Hong Kong. And dinner for two at 208 Ducas Otto. And Ducas Otto's PR girl is here. Put your arm up in the hair. You. She's much more attractive than these tickets, so go and talk to her. All right. So these are the prizes at the end of tonight. So now let's get into the interview, because you're all being so rowdy. Okay, could you quieten down a bit for those who want to listen? Hello. Shh. Please. Okay, we're gonna show a little video of, in case you haven't, who has visited CNN Go in this room? Who has made a travel decision based on CNN Go? Who has clicked on an ad on CNN Go? Oh, okay. Did you get a discount? Sean, did you get, was it a landmark? Ad? Langham. Yeah, LA something. Right? No? Alright, so we're going to show a little video of CNN Go in Sydney. Now, bear in mind, this is the internet, so it's multimedia. Let's see a little video of CNN Go talking about Korea. Oh, it's Sydney. A vignette. So CNN Go is going into the TV world. Here we go.
Hi, my name is Laura Innova. I'm 19 years old and I'm from North Narrabeen in Sydney, Australia. At the beginning of 2010, I won the ASP World Junior Championship, and so that was an amazing way to kickstart my year last year and and I ended up qualifying for the Women's World Tour, which is pretty much the big leagues in surfing. Everyone in Sydney, everyone in the Northern Beaches, everyone in Australia, we all love the beach. It's a huge part of our culture, and it's epic, it's really amazing. But I've travelled the world, seen so many beaches, but I still think the Northern Beaches are the prettiest beaches in the world.
There you go, there's a little vignette. So, let's get back to the interview. Let me just get these little things going. Okay, so Andrew, my guest tonight is Andrew DiMario. He's got a really cool title, Editor-in-Chief of CNN Go. Andrew actually was involved in setting up CNN.com back in 2000. Put your hand up if you read CNN.com every day. Do you work for CNN? So Andrew's quite an experienced man in that space. And then he went away to England, and then he came back again to set up this startup. I had some people moan on the internet that CNN Go wasn't a startup. So Andrew, tell us what it's like to start a new business under the wing of a very large multimedia conglomerate.
It was actually a great deal of hard work, more than anything else. But firstly, I must really congratulate you on the comfortableness of this stage. It really makes a tall, skinny guy look very comfortable, and sort of really highlights my very poor posture, so apologies there. I first joined CNN Go after quite a few years with CNN and Turner, actually just before 2009, and the product itself mutated a lot, even over the time that I've been involved in it. Before I was involved, it was actually originally conceived as being a weather-type channel. I think that was one of the guises that it had. That was many years.
CNN Go was going to be a weather channel? Or CNN?
This is before it even had a title. And actually, the title itself is another interesting, convoluted story involving way too many people and late-night phone calls. But I think to answer your question, to set it up under a large company, well, there's a lot that goes into it. There's firstly, you need to understand why we did it. And that's probably another question you want to get to later. But to set up something within Turner or NCNN was actually extremely hard, because we were doing things that the company hadn't done before, even though, you know, the CNN.com and so forth. We were setting up people in various places. We were pushing the limits of the legal system, understanding just what it takes to hire people in certain places under the organizational structure that we had. We had to work out how to commission, engage, and also pay freelancers. And obviously we had to work out what the concept was, how we were going to execute it, where was that money going to come from, where did the support come from within the organization. And at all those stages, it was a really, really tough sell, because at the end of the day, Turner, CNN, Time Warner is a commercial company, and always looking at the bottom line. So there has to be really good incentive as to why to do this. What are you going to bring to the greater company? What are we going to achieve out of all of this?
But the advantages you had the money, right? Most startups are bootstrapping. So you had cash, right?
We didn't have cash. Like every other startup, if you've ever worked at CNN and Turner before, you know that it's very, very tight. We had to spend actually a lot of money before the end of 2009 to actually get the development in place. So we had to engage, for example, a company on a product we hadn't even properly conceived yet, just because we had to spend that money before it ran out for 2009. So that's one example. But every bit along the way, we had very, very tight money. We didn't have any VC sort of money coming in. In fact, we had a group within Turner that no longer existed, which, again, is another story, that was actually called the New Products Group.
I think one of them just smashed their glass in anger, right?
The New Products Group was what funded and bankrolled CNN Go, at least for the first part, before they were disbanded by Turner itself. So we didn't have much money. In fact, when I joined the company, we were originally going to be 20 cities across Asia. I had a very nice budget. And then by the time I signed the dotted line, it had withered down to 6, all well into money. And even today, you know, it's about traffic, it's about sales, it's about making sure you're a commercial, viable product. If we're not that, then we don't exist.
But you're an editor-in-chief, right? So how do you get content for a website? I mean, nowadays it's all about crowdsourcing and all these big words and stuff like that. So how do you get content onto CNN Go? Where does it come from? Are you paying people? Are you ripping it off Google? Baidu? Twitter? Where are you getting? Are you crowdsourcing for free from Twitter?
As you know, CNN has exemplary standards and practices. And the mission was always to make sure that we lived up to a grand promise, which is to make sure we are a real insider's guide to these cities or the topics or the regions, the things that we cover. And so in each of our cities, we've got 8 of them now. We launched Seoul just recently.
And what are those cities?
Bangkok, Mumbai, Singapore, Tokyo, Hong Kong, Seoul, Sydney, and I'm missing
Shanghai.
And in each of those cities, we instilled a city editor who's a CNN Go staff member. There's also a senior editorial team in Hong Kong. Each one of those city editors produces content, and they also manage a stable of freelancers, which we pay, we engage, they're on a contract. And at the moment, we have around 600 freelancers across the region and the world. So if you think about one city editor, Zoe Lee, for example, in Hong Kong.
Are you here, Zoe? Where's Zoe?
I think Zoe's out on a shoot right now. But she manages around 40 or 50 different freelancers. And so that's a lot of ideas that are coming in. And when we engage freelancers, we want to make sure that we are getting from them and commissioning with them either our pictures or theirs, stories, ideas, galleries, videos, whatever, that they actually... They know. They need to know the topics that they're talking about. We don't want to read from Joe Schmo who doesn't know anything about hotels, for example. What's the point of reading about Joe's article if he doesn't really know what he's
talking
about?
So you're not like the Huffington Post. You actually pay people, right?
Yeah, we pay everybody. We are professional. We engage them professionally. I think the only people we don't pay are those who contribute via UGC. And we operate iReport. Which is our UGC side of things. So that's the only side of things where we don't actually pay.
So iReport, from what I remember, iReport was basically Americans chasing tornadoes, right? When it first started, not to put it down, but it was a lot of people there with their cameras chasing live news. How do you turn iReport into...
It still is. Tornado shots are great. But iReport, I think, began as a very small team. It was an idea many, many years ago, and now it's extremely successful, both financially and also in terms of traffic and user engagement and community for CNN. So travel and lifestyle is the obvious best fit for iReport. Everybody, you look at Facebook, everybody's sending photos, telling their stories. I've been to Bali. I know that the W Hotel in Seminyak is great, but if you're going to stay there, you want to get this sort of room and you want to go to... the restaurant down the road, Matisse or something, for a great French meal. Everybody sort of has their ideas of everything. They want to share that with everyone else. So iReport, CNN Go, and with CNN is also, it's a really ideal fit for the way that people want to engage with other people.
iReport is the video part, right?
iReport is video, it's stories, it's images, whatever people want to communicate in and send their message across.
So is anybody here a budding writer, travel writer, looking for a job? No.
Actually, I mean, if anyone's interested in getting published on CNN, if you go to iReport, there's various topics that are assigned. We have our own section, CNN Go, iReport. You quickly can look at the assignments we've got. You can suggest your own. We go through a vetting process to make sure that PR people don't get too excited and send in stories touting how wonderful the pizza is at 208, which is on Hollywood Road, just down there.
How much should pay you for that?
We got some vouchers, yeah.
All right, let's talk about the content. So you cover Japan, right? And recently there's been a rather dramatic happening in Japan. The whole Fukushima earthquake, tsunami, etc. How did that affect the way that CNN Go went from being like a kind of, you know, evergreen travel blog to suddenly talking about a country that's going through turmoil?
Well, if you look at our content, you know that we talk about places to see, things to do, to eat, maybe an interesting story about a character or an icon of Tokyo, Shibuya area or something like that. Now, when a big disaster like that happens, it's not much point running that sort of stuff. Nobody cares. And also, you need to be reactive to the environment that's around you. And that's a huge news story. Actually, we were a very fortunate place because, like I said, we have so many freelancers and our own staff. We quickly scrambled. It's a big story. People in Tokyo, people in the world want to know what's going on. We were actually able to get our CNN Go staff and our freelancers on air with CNN. They were actually the first and second local people on air talking about what was going on, even as the live pictures of the tsunamis and all that horrible destruction was unfolding before our eyes. So that was the immediate sort of response, getting people on the ground talking about what was going on, letting everybody know what was going on. Further to that, there was a lot of confusion, particularly in Tokyo, which is what we focus on, about what exactly was the scene there. And on CNN Go, we like to make sure that regardless of the natural disaster or anything bad happening, that we can actually talk about and communicate to audience about what the vibe is, what's happening in Hong Kong, what are people talking about, is it a plus uncle video, really old example, or other stuff that's very topical. So in Tokyo, it was natural for us to talk about things like, well, what is the train situation? Is Narita open? How do you get to Narita? Are supermarkets actually running out of food? What's the real situation? So that's where we use our staff to provide that. We actually also, not only on our site, we combine that with our Twitter feed. We turned over our CNN Go Twitter feed to be purely about what the situation was in Tokyo, how that would relate to people coming in, wanting to go out, people worried about loved ones, people living there going, well, what do I need to do? How do I feed my kids tonight? So all that sort of stuff.
I mean, that's interesting, although there's a lot of people like that. So the real time, I mean, travel has become, typically it's people writing blogs, right? They're writing their experience of a trip somewhere. Do you see people like TripAdvisor? I mean, who are your competitors? Is it the Wall Street Journal with their scene? Is it Financial Times app? Is it TripAdvisor? Who? When people want to look for content related to travel, hey, excuse me, oi, thank you. I feel like a teacher. Behave back there. Behave nicely, you get a USB. Thank you.
Our competitors, right. I think we're a very unique entity because I don't think we actually have a single competitor that sort of does what we do. Within Hong Kong, you might say there's Time Out, there's HK Magazine, there's sections of the SMP or the local newspapers. And sure, they are competitors, but on that sort of microscopic or micro sort of market. Whereas we're a lot broader, we're regional, we're a lot more international than that. So then you might compare us to a TripAdvisor or a Lonely Planet, but again, it doesn't really serve. TripAdvisor doesn't have great in-depth articles. It's very UGC fit. Lonely Planet doesn't have particularly good feature articles. It's got often very outdated information. It's not as current, doesn't have the same currency and daily updates that we do. We publish anywhere from 1 to 5 pieces per city per day, which if you do the maths is quite a lot. So there are a lot of those competitors, but also I think what's important in CNN Go is we recognize that we're not unique in this space. And if there's a great article in Time Out, then we want our audience to know about it. And we'll sort of direct all our traffic to that article because it's a good piece on some local celebrity who's doing something fantastic. So I think that's an important part of what we do. And I forgot the last bit of your question.
I did too, sorry. So you talked about traffic. I mean, we've got a few ad marketer type people in the room here. We're all about traffic and lead generation. I saw a recent report from CNN saying that one person could share an article and it would bring in 5,000 people to CNN.com. In terms of CNN Go, because it's about travel and it's kind of a little bit softer, where are people coming from? How are they finding you? Are they bookmarking you? Are they finding you on search? Are they finding you through Facebook? How are people getting to you?
A variety of ways. Firstly, we have our own site, so they come direct to us. Secondly, we have various partners, whether they're Yahoo in India, in Hong Kong, Sina in Hong Kong. We've also got RenRen in China, mainland. We have CNN.com, CNN TV, which you saw a little bit before.
So how does it work with RenRen and Yahoo? Are you saying partners?
Let me answer the rest of your question, and then we'll get to that one. But search engines, we get around 15% of our traffic. Social media, I think, accounts for anywhere from 10 to 20 on the day. It varies a little bit depending on the topics that we're talking about. Most of our audience...
You get more from social media than you do from search.
At the moment, I think there was a study released yesterday or the day before that said that Facebook accounts for about 38-40% of all shareable stories and links on the internet right now. So we're definitely sort of getting up to that sort of figure. Most of our audience, I think about 60-70% come from the Asia-Pacific region. The rest of that minority comes from the United States and Europe.
You've got 6 countries, right? So, sure. Hey, you lot at the back, we're going to turn the music up, the microphone. Bodge, can you turn up the microphones? Louder, because they can't hear at the back. Sorry guys, this is a really long bar, and the microphones at the back are not so good. Speakers, sorry. Can you do it? Thank you. So we were just talking about whether traffic... Maybe we can talk really loudly. Should we try that? We were just talking about the can you hear at the back there?
Yeah, sure.
You can. Excellent. Is it... Bodge, can you turn it up a bit, please? Is it loud? Do you want to talk a bit, Andrew? Can you talk?
How's that? Well, there's a bit of feedback.
I'm just about to get electrocuted by beer. So can you hear us at the back? Is it better now? Put your hands, put a thumb up in the air if you can hear us in the back. Lovely. Thank you. So does that mean you're going to keep nice and quiet? Bodge. No. Casey. Shh. Stop sabotaging my event. So we were just talking about where traffic comes from, and you were saying that a lot of it comes from social media, and that you're getting, I can't remember the numbers now, but in terms of people coming locally, now, you have six different cities, so I presume eight. So does that mean that you have language versions in Korean, Chinese?
Yeah, so we have...
Bodge, turn it down a bit, please. Bodge?
We have...
Sorry, you can either have reverb or silence.
Okay, so Xining goes also in traditional Chinese, simplified Chinese, Japanese, and next week we launch it in Korean. And I think we're the only Turner CNN product that's in five languages right now. Actually, there's an interesting story just about how we operate in China. You asked earlier about RenRen and social media and that sort of stuff. And I think for us, those local languages are very key for us. We need to make sure that we can cater for those audiences. And what's very interesting is that what works in English doesn't necessarily work in whatever language, particularly simplified Chinese.
So you mean you don't just directly translate it, you actually write, the articles are written in a different way.
We do get translation, and then that translation is edited by one of our staffers. And, you know, CNN Go likes to think that it has a unique voice, a particular tone, a very distinctive style that is sometimes witty, sometimes snarky, sometimes a little more conversational. And while that works fantastically in English, most of the time, in Chinese or Korean or Japanese, that particular piece or phrase might not work. So you need to make sure you understand what the equivalent is, and if you are going to try and be funny, that it actually works. Otherwise, whoever reads your article is not going to be too impressed and unlikely to ever come back. So I think we need to make sure, again, talking about being that insider guide, is that we have the staff that can actually translate those things perfectly, that can understand the cultural nuances and differences, and be able to engage our audiences in the way that they actually want to be engaged. They respond and they become somehow attached with our product.
So in the world we live in at the moment, it's all about content, and it's all about you know, valid, trusted content. Are you getting a lot of PR companies, advertisers coming to you and saying, hey, we love your content, can we brand it, can we package it, can we use it in our airplane? Can we use it on our iPad app? Can we use it, whatever?
Yeah, for sure. And I think what's a great thing about CNN Go, slightly different from CNN, is we have a little bit more opportunity to be flexible in our content and what we do with it and how we distribute it. But what we can't do, and this is different to a lot of travel lifestyle publications out there, is that we can't, you know, accept freebies. We don't take junkets, we don't take free meals, we have to pay for everything. We have to maintain the same sort of editorial integrity, the standards and practices that CNN employs, and make sure that that's across our site. We need to have the reputation of reliability as well as authority, and you can't do that if you're trying to talk about some brand of watch while you're having a watch advertiser next to you. That's what we don't do. If we do any other content that's related to a particular area that's sponsored by an area, it's marked as advertorial, it's done by a totally different team that's not CNN Go, and it's very distinctive and placed quite differently on the site.
So talking about your content, at the moment you have a website, but are you? I read recently that the FT decided, right, I don't like iTunes,
iTunes is taking too much of my profit. I'm going to set up a web app. So, are you going into the field of distributed content? I mean, at the moment you have .com. My God, you lot are so damn rude. Excuse me. Hello. Whoa. Please. For the people that want to listen, could you just be a little bit quiet for another 15 minutes, please? Thank you. You can network afterwards. There's plenty of time to chat, exchange cards, whatever. This is my father in me coming out of me. So, just talking about the distribution of content. You have CNNGo.com. Are you taking that content and putting it into apps? Are you turning it into mobile web pages? What are you doing with that content?
With our content on CNNGo?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, we are actually about to launch, coming in summer, will be apps for iPhone, Android, and Nokia. That'd be very tailorable. You can make your own city your homepage if you like. It's searchable. It's effectively going to be our own sort of newsreader of our own content. But I think the question that is a little bit more interesting is we're one of the few companies out there that actually produces our own original content. And this day and age of all these different sites and apps and everything, they all need content to fill them or to drive them. And we have that content. And while we're here, you know, doing our own sort of executions of how we present and give that content, we're always on the lookout to tie up with partners that make sense to partner with, that are a natural fit for what CNNGo does and wants to do. We have that opportunity on how to distribute our content to a wider manner, how to make sure that we get the partners that have got this great idea. You know, this is the app that we want to do. It's going to be the travel destination killer app out there. We need content, and we are the content kings in this field right now in this region. So it's a natural fit for those sorts of partnerships.
So like Cathay Pacific, right? Who's got the Cathay Pacific app? It has really uninteresting city guides, right? You go and look at the city guide, it's like, this city has 12 million people. The sewage system was built in 1964. So are you working with airlines and hotels? And is that what happens? Is that how you see the evolution of your content?
I think so, and you already know that Cathay have a deal with Lux City Guides. I actually used Lux City Guides in Bali recently, and it was an interesting experience because it didn't really cater for what I wanted. But in answer to your question, we look at partnerships with airlines, with hotels. We did a great one with Citibank, a bank, a few months ago, late last year, where we did the Best Eats Awards for all our regions, and that was a sponsored tie-up with Citibank. They provided the sponsorship and stuff. We did all the editorial. So there's lots of opportunities to really share our content and engage with the right sort of partners, whether they be airlines, banks, Visas, MasterCards, hotel chains, whatever it might be.
Nice one. So, what about your business model? You are kind of a startup, and you haven't got much cash, but you're under pressure to bring in money. So where is that money coming from? Is it coming from banner ads? Is it coming from these partnerships you're talking about? Where is the money? I know you're not the money guy, but I'm going to ask you anyway.
Well, it's coming from all of that. And I think what's very important, where CNNGo is great, is we have a lot of opportunity to explore different ideas, different executions. I think if we just rely on pure banner ads, we might lose out on some even better opportunities that are out there. And I think also in this space, you know, you also need to show a little bit of creativity, not just in what you do content-wise, but in the actual solution and the ad solution that you provide. You know, people are bombarded every day with ads, and some you like, some you don't like, some are very subtle, some are viral, some you don't even know are ads. And it's hard to tell where they work, it's hard to tell always what the engagement is. So I think we have a platform that's perfect for a lot of, not so much experimentation, but to really explore what different opportunities are out there. Right now, I don't know the exact mix, but we've got banner ad executions, we've got sponsored packages, executions like the Citibank Best Eats one that I mentioned before, and there's a whole raft in between that we've done. I think, how many sponsors have we had? So 40, 50 or something?
So, but you, what I was also interested in, that you have vignettes. Now, CNNGo originally, was it very much, the goal was to create a text-based thing, or was the idea
the world is becoming, you know, video dominated.
I think the goal of CNN Go is it becomes the travel brand execution for all of CNN. The vignettes that we saw earlier are actually from our TV show, which airs on CNN International. It's called CNN Go. It runs for half an hour. Our latest episode aired today. It's about Beijing. So that's one side of CNN Go. We also distribute our content to CNN domestic on TV. If you actually watch a lot of CNN I, you'll see a lot of CNN Go stories on CNN I and also CNN US. You'll see us in CNN Espanol, on CNN Mexico. And we're even distributing our content on the Tribune network of media in the United States right now, among others. So there's a lot of arms of CNN Go, and I think this all points towards CNN Go becoming a bigger travel brand in itself on CNN.
So in a way, I suppose that's the advantage for you, being part of a large network, is that once you have that content, your ability to get it out into all these partners is accelerated compared to somebody in Hong Kong Science Park who sets up a travel blog. I mean, you've got...
For sure, but it also needs to make financial sense. You know, there wouldn't be a CNN Go TV show if advertising wasn't sold around it. We wouldn't be on all these other platforms if it wasn't bringing in traffic and thus ad revenue. So there needs to be a commercial reason as to why we're doing these things. And we wouldn't be doing them if they weren't successful.
In China, I know a lot of sites get copied. And copying is kind of the highest form of flattery in China. So is there a CNNGo.cn that is basically a mirror image of what you do?
We find daily that our content, particularly in China and Vietnam, is plagiarized completely. And I think we have to accept some of that, but we also have to challenge a lot of it, and we do.
So let's talk a little bit about your technology. So we have a few at the back there, a few geeks in here. Real geeks, true Uber geeks. What was CNN Go built on WordPress, or you know, what was the technology used to build CNN Go?
CNN Go is on Drupal, and
who likes Drupal in this room? Put your hand up. Who's a Drupal user? Can't see. Who prefers WordPress? Oh, Joomla. One Joomla. The tallest guy in the room is a Joomla guy.
Actually, I'm going to ask a question to Pauline. Are there any Drupal web developers out there? Anyone? Anyone? Okay, well, I'm going to do a very gratuitous ad here. We are actually looking for a Drupal web developer. Is Brent in the room? Brent, guy here with his hand up. If anyone is interested or knows a friend who knows a friend who knows a friend who knows Drupal, please see Brent. Keep your hand up, Brent. There we are. That job has been posted, I think, today, so that's hot off the press.
Excellent. So you use Drupal, right? Why? I know you're not the technical guy. Maybe Brent can tell us. Why would you use Drupal over any other technology?
That's a very, very good question with a very, very simple answer. As far as I can tell, because this was done before I properly joined, Nina, you can shake your head and tell me to shut up if I need to. Shut up,
not you at the back, him.
But the main reason we're on Drupal, and I'll give away a major secret here, is because back in the end of 2009, the head of our little project in the new products group in Atlanta decided that he wanted to engage a company that would put the platform on Drupal.
So it was a personal preference, it's nothing to do with anything else. Do you like Drupal?
It was a professional
Do you like
decision.
Drupal? Out of 10, is Drupal like 5 or 4 or 7?
Well, for me to answer that question
accurately,
I'd have to have used all the other ones.
You've been speaking to PR people, haven't you?
I have to hire someone. At my time at CNN, they had this bespoke internal CMS, which
Can
is very catered to whatever.
Fucking unruly and rude crowd at Web Wednesday being annoying as hell. All right, who's Wingless Prime? Wingless Prime, there you go. Thank you. So you don't know. But when you were at CNN.com, what was it then?
As I said, it was very bespoke. It's internal. I think Drupal has a lot of benefits. I mean, these guys can pull stuff off the shelf that other people have already created, yeah, or they can work on it themselves. I think for us, we're very dynamic. We update a lot daily, 30, 40 times a day. And so we really need a system that can handle that and is very easy to adjust, add new things backwards and forwards. And I must give credit to our Drupal team because they have done a great job.
So does Drupal, I don't know enough about Drupal, does Drupal allow you to create a website that is readable by a mobile phone in terms of access?
Yes. Yes. Well, we have a mobile phone, a WAP server for CNNGO.
Okay. How much?
So the answer is yes.
So because this is about the travel industry, how much of that traffic is people accessing from their phones? Do you know? I mean, do people mostly come through mobile phones, or are they still?
No, we get mostly online. I think last time I had a look, I think of our traffic that comes via the site, if that was 100%, you'll get an additional 10 to 15% from mobile traffic.
And from any particular country? Because obviously now you're covering so many different cities.
I don't know, but I'm pretty sure it's quite localized.
All right, look, so I've got one solution for all this noise, is I'm going to take questions from the floor. So if you've got a question, please put your hand up. Then we got a question? I don't see any questions. No questions. You're all so shy. You've been talking so much that you get a lovely USB if you get it right, right? No questions. Brilliant. All right, no questions. So, I'll tell you what. One question. Say your name and your question.
This is David. Just want to know, how do you compare yourself, CNNGO, with Lonely Planet?
I don't really compare us to Lonely Planet because do you spend much time on the Lonely Planet website? I think where I like to think that we're different from Lonely Planet is that we are a lot more dynamic than Lonely Planet. We update ourselves daily. There's a lot more currency with what we do. Lonely Planet also has a totally different audience. They're people that are really looking to travel to that place and they want to know the real basic ingredients of that particular place. I often talk about what we do in the sense of when you visit Paris. You know, the first time you go to Paris, you go to the Eiffel Tower, you go to the Sacré Cœur, you might go to a museum or two. The second time, you might do a little bit of that, but you start to do other things as well. The fifth, the sixth, the seventh time, you forget all about that stuff because you've already done it. What you really want is a true local experience, and that's what we aim to do. So we want to make sure that, you know, if you were going to Paris, that you'd get that real sort of Parisian experience that isn't going to be in a Lonely Planet, because that insider who really knew that particular area or that aspect of Paris was able to give that information to you. It's like when you travel, say, to Taipei, you've got a friend in Taipei, hey, Jimmy, I'm going to come over, what should I do? And he's going to tell you things that may be in the guidebook, but most likely are not. And we want to be that Jimmy, that particular person. And that's, I think, what our strength is. And we also make sure that we deliver that content in our particular tone, which ideally is the way that Jimmy would be talking to you. You know, he's not going to use flowery cliches to explain it. He's going to tell you the real thing in the way that you understand.
So I have another question. Are you allowing people to come to your site and comment? Are you allowing Discuss, or are you using Facebook Connect so people can come in and post comments?
Yeah, we use Discuss, and our comments section has been extremely popular. Depending on the story, some of our larger comments are in the thousands at the moment, particularly the somewhat controversial ones, or the ones that really touch on people's emotions or have some sort of connection with them.
Yeah, talking about controversial, like, I was in Singapore 2 weeks ago, and the headline in the local newspaper was, "Is Singapore boring? CNN list sparks debate." Who, put your hand up if you think Singapore's boring. Put your hand up if you think Hong Kong's boring. One of you, two, three of you, Singaporeans. So, this just creates traffic, right? It's just a way to get traffic. It's just PR, right? Well, or was this the kind of thing that gets people hot and sweaty under the collar?
Well, I think what people really liked about that article is all the traffic for that article was generated from Singapore, nowhere else. And it was Singapore people saying, you know what? That is so true. Singapore must be the only place in the world where people go to the airport for dinner. And that's what happens in Singapore. And all the people in Singapore actually say, you know what, that's right, maybe we are a little bit boring. But I'll also counter that and
say, you can watch aeroplanes. I like watching aeroplanes.
And there's a slide there and all that sort of stuff. But a lot of... I'll let you counter that and say that's one article where we decided to do that boring thing because it was kind of topical, and a freelancer actually pitched that to us and we said, yeah, great idea. But that's sort of one negative article that actually is actually quite a positive article as well. But we published, I think, maybe 2,000 or 3,000 other bits of content about Singapore. Maybe 2 or 3 of them are negative. So when something gets publicity like that, I think more than anything, it's really touched on a water cooler topic for everyone, and I think that's great.
So you weren't blocked?
No.
That they didn't decide?
The only people that were a little bit upset were our sales team, who got some frantic calls from the Singapore Tourism Board to say, what the hell are these bastards doing? I thought they wrote nice stuff, but we'll deal with that.
Any more questions? Here you go.
Hi, I'm Stephen. Earlier I heard you mentioned that you got a lot of traffic from social media or through social media. Is that because you post messages on Twitter, or do people actively talk about you, or do you actively engage in using these platforms, and yes, if so, how?
Stephen, yeah? Actually, the answer to the question is all of those things. An example of where we outreach is we post on Facebook 4 or 5 times a day. We also post another example on LinkedIn. We have a Twitter feed. LinkedIn content's a little bit different from the Facebook, slightly different audiences. Maybe LinkedIn might be a bit more business orientated, perhaps catering for an older, more executive audience. Whereas Facebook, you know, depending on the story, it's quite different. But I think, and where we fail to sort of capture the traffic, not so much capture the traffic, but we can't factor in traffic to our figures, is from that engagement on Facebook and those sort of communities and forums that are created on Facebook or Twitter or LinkedIn that don't relate to, you know, they're not numbers that we can give sales or clients because it's happening out there. And the more of that that happens and the more brand awareness, the better everything is for everyone. The question was, do we use sponsored tweets? We don't. We do all our own stuff outward. So nothing sponsored from us at all.
Okay, we're going to take 2 more questions. I don't know, no, we'll take a few more. I'll come back to you more. But I'll go here at the bar.
So it's Doug. Before you spoke about plagiarism, you mentioned that you're talking about content and how it's really important. What do you do, like what methods are you taking to counterattack plagiarism? How do you stop it?
You mean from other people taking our stuff or from perhaps our freelancers looking to plagiarize from someone else? I'll talk about
both ways, actually.